In this time of desperation, when all we know is doubt and fear, there is only one foundation. We believe, we believe. In this broken generation, when all is dark, you help us see. There is only one salvation. Father, we believe in Jesus Christ. We believe in the Holy Spirit, and He's given us new life. We believe in the crucifixion. We believe that He conquered death. We believe in the resurrection, and He's coming back again. We believe. So let our faith be more than anthems, greater than the songs we sing. And in our weakness and temptations,
let's join our hearts together now as we ask God's blessing on us. Well, Lord, we do pray this morning that we would be aware of what you want to do in our lives and in this church. And Lord, we open ourselves now and we say, we do believe, and we want to ask you to help our unbelief. And I pray, oh Lord, that you would be with everything that is said and done this morning. And I pray that we would do everything for your glory. And Lord, I pray that you would draw us closer together as the body of Christ that has met here at this church building this morning. And we know that You are here because you said when two or three gather together in my name, you would be there. And so, Lord, we thank you that you're here and pray that you would have your way among us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Well, good morning. David is going to come and share announcements and, yep.
Just a reminder, there's Bible study on Tuesday morning at 10 o'clock. We're currently in the book of Revelations, and with that in mind, our call to worship today is from the book of Revelation. And it's entitled, Worship the One Who is Worthy. And just remember that when we're worshiping, we're just practicing, because what's going to take place in heaven is going to be way better than this. So even if we don't get it right each and every week, just remember, we're just practicing. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain to receive power and wealth and wisdom and strength and honor and glory and praise, from Revelations 5:12. Bible scholars tell us that whenever a Roman emperor entered a city, the citizens shouted, Worthy! The Apostle John, who had been exiled because he confessed Jesus as Lord, knew that only Jesus was worthy, not the emperor. Today we are invited to see, with spiritual eyes, what John saw happening in heaven. We are summoned to join with the multitudes of angels and other creatures in singing that the Lord is worthy. God is worthy of our praise and honor because he is the creator and savior. We owe every breath to the one who made us, and we have new life purchased by the blood of Christ because he was slain for our sake. Our Lord Jesus, the Lamb who was slain, is worthy to open the scrolls of history, explained in Revelations chapter 6 through 9. The one who died on the cross rose from the dead, giving us new life in order to serve and rule with him, is the one who now reigns. All authority in heaven and on earth belongs to him, and his kingdom will never end. Shall we lift up our voices and sing with all the creatures of our God and King? To him be praise and honor and glory and power forever and ever. Amen. In this morning's prayer, we worship you, Lord, our creator, sustainer, savior, and king. We bow before you because worthy is the Lamb who was slain. To you be all glory and praise. Amen.
Amen.
You are worthy of
Well, it's good to know that we didn't just come to see each other, or not that there's anything wrong with anybody, but we didn't come just to see each other, and we didn't come to do some kind of business or some kind of transaction, but we came to worship God. We came to be in the presence of Almighty God. I read something that someone had written this week, and they said that the highest priority for the Christian is to share their faith with others. And while I agree that that is a very good and lofty goal, that shouldn't be our main goal. Our main goal is to worship God, to love Him more than anything else. And that's what we have come here to do. So we have some answers to prayer, I am sure. I had something happen yesterday, a small thing, but I think we need to notice. And actually, Christina noticed it more than me, and she wasn't even with me. But I went on a bike ride yesterday over in Coventry, because there's a nice rail trail over there. And I ran out of water, and that's another story, but I ran out of water. So I went to this rec park where there was baseball games going on, and they had restrooms there. And I said, well, I can just get some water out of one of the taps there. I don't have a problem drinking tap water. And the restroom was locked. I said, oh no, what am I going to do for water? And I came out, and there were a couple of ladies getting out of the car. And I said to one of them, to both of them, I said, is there a place around here? Do they have a hydration station or something that where you can get water? And the younger lady picked up this big jug, and she said, well, you can have some of our water. And I said, I don't want to take your good water. She said, oh, no, the kids only never finish it, and you can have a bottle of my water. So she gave me her water, and Christina said, see, the Lord put her there for you. And it's true. Often we miss the blessings that are right there in front of us because we don't pay attention, you know? And yes, she did. She had, and it was good water. It's very cold. So, anyone else? We need to be in prayer this morning for Nancy. She is in surgery this morning down in Providence. So we need to keep her in prayer. Okay, well, let's stand together. Lord, we stand today in honor of you, as David read the call to worship earlier, and how your name is above every name, and you're really the only one worthy of our praise. But we stand in honor knowing that we are in the presence of God Almighty, the one who is able to do anything. There's nothing too hard for you. So we lift up these people who are in need today, and pray for Sheila, and pray for Nancy, pray for Sue and her family, pray for this church and the pastoral search that is still going on. And Lord, I pray that you would bring the pastor to this church that is your choice. And I pray that there would be a settledness in everyone's heart and mind, that this is your provision as well. Lord, I pray today that you would be with this community and with all the people that live in the surrounding communities around here. And I pray that there would be an awakening and a hungering for you like hasn't been for years and years, maybe decades. I pray, oh God, that you would bring people to you. And I pray for our family members. I pray, Lord, not only for their physical well-being, but I pray that you would bring them to a saving knowledge of you. And Lord, if they know you and have drifted away, I pray you would bring them back and Change their lifestyle. Help them to live for you, O God, we pray. And so we lift up all these things to you, O Lord, who taught us to pray, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Amen. And we're going to sing some praise and worship songs now. So lift up your hearts.
My heart, heal my soul, speak. Your hidden glory in creation now revealed in you, our Christ. What a beautiful name it is. What a beautiful name it is. The name of Jesus Christ, my King. What a beautiful name.
We're going to hear our scripture this morning from Psalm 71, and Paul's going to read for us.
In you, Lord, I have taken refuge. Let me never be put to shame. In your righteousness, rescue me and deliver me. Turn your ear to me and save me. Be my rock of refuge, to which I can always go. Give the command to save me. For you are my rock and my fortress. Deliver me, my God, from the hand of the wicked, from the grasp of those who are evil and cruel. For you have been my hope, sovereign Lord, my confidence since my youth. From birth I have relied on you. You brought me forth from my mother's womb. I will ever praise you. I have become a sign to many. You are my strong refuge. My mouth is filled with your praise, declaring your splendor all day long. Do not cast me away when I am old. Do not forsake me when my strength is gone. For my enemies speak against me. Those who wait to kill me conspire together. They say, God has forsaken him. Pursue him and seize him, for no one will rescue him. Do not be far from me, my God. Come quickly, God, to help me. May my accusers perish in shame. May those who want to harm me be covered with scorn and disgrace. As for me, I will always have hope. I will praise you more and more.
This is a song that kind of goes with the last song. What a wonderful name it is, the name of Jesus. There's no one like our Lord Jesus. But it's a little bit more upbeat. You look in a mirror to see how you look. Glance through the papers or you read a good book. You can look over them, you can look around here. But it's the Lord you need to look at, and he's standing so near. His name is Jesus. Jesus, he's the Lord. Peter, John the Baptist saw him coming. He said to the crowd, behold the Lamb of God, this is him right now. I baptize you in water, but he's mightier than I. He'll baptize you with the Holy Ghost and fire. His name is Jesus. Jesus, he's the one. He's the Lamb of God. Takes away sin, he'll cleanse your life when you let him in. You need to look to Jesus, think his faith, because he's the author and the finisher of our faith. Behold the Lamb of God, takes away sin, he changed my life when I let him in. His name is Jesus. Jesus, he's the one. Peter walked out on the water. Oh, Jesus walked out on the water. Jesus walked. One day, all was going well till he looked at the waves. He cried, Lord, save me, as he started to sink. Jesus pulled him up and said, keep your eyes on me. His name is Jesus. It's Jesus, and he's the one. His mercy is everlasting, his power is strong. His love will come and get you no matter how you're wrong. He'll change your life, make you want to shout, somebody help me, who I'm talking about. It's Jesus, Jesus, he's the one. He's the Lamb of God, takes away sin. Cleanse your life when you let him in. You need to look to Jesus, seek his face, because he's the author and the finisher of our faith. Behold the Lamb of God, he takes away sin. He changed my life when I let him in. His name is Jesus. Jesus, he's the one. It's Jesus, Jesus, he's the one. He's Jesus, Jesus, and he's the one. But the theme of the song is, it's all about him. It's all about Jesus, and I'm thankful today that we can know him, not know about him, but we can really know him. In our world that we live in, we're often confronted by things that disturb us. And I talked about this some a couple of weeks ago when I was preaching about the confidence that we can have in him. Because we can see things and hear things, not only first hand, but we can also hear through the internet. We know if it's there, it's probably true. The glut of news that's around the world, and at times some of the stuff we hear can be upsetting. I would like to say it's everything is upbeat. One of the things that I have been reminded of lately is the verse from the Psalms that says, "This is the day that the Lord has made. We will rejoice and be glad in it." And no matter what is going on in our lives, we need to remind ourselves, but this is the day that the Lord has made. Yeah, we may not see things going on like we would like them to be, but we can praise him in spite of what is going on. Before Jesus was born and came as a little baby in the manger, it was a really, really dark period in the history of Israel. It was a dark, dark time. They had turned away from God because of through idolatry, and they had been captive or exiled, and they had but there was always a remnant of people that trusted God. And I was thinking back to the Ezra and Nehemiah's time, when the remnant was allowed, these exiles were allowed to go back to Jerusalem, and they went back actually to rebuild the walls of Jerusalem and rebuild the city and the temple of Jerusalem. And it should have been a real exciting wave the flag and let's rejoice because this is a celebration time. But they came back quietly, almost like a beaten and defeated people, because things were not like they once had been. It wasn't the glory days of Israel when they came back, even though thankfully they could come back. And then, but through those 400 years just before Jesus came, there had been people who had been waiting and looking for the Messiah. But the trust that they had had in mostly the religious leadership had been undermined. There had been compromises, and there had been a lot of contamination with the pure worship that Israel had once known. And so their faith and their prayer was waiting for the Messiah to come. But there was a remnant of people, and right after Jesus' birth, we see Anna, the prophetess, who was in the temple. We see Simeon, the old man. We see Zacharias and Elizabeth, John the Baptist's father and mother, and we see Mary and Joseph and others who kept expecting the revelation of the glory of God. God always had a remnant. We need to know, I don't know that we're the remnant, but I look around at the world in general, and I look at the church in general, and I say, wow, America has gotten really, really secular, hasn't it? I saw something on Facebook, so it's got to be true, of course, as I said before. But something on Facebook just struck me this week, and it was, has anyone thought of unplugging America and plugging it back in? You know, what is wrong with our country? What is wrong with this land that used to be known as a Christian nation? It was built on Christian principles. People came to New England. The Puritans came. They were looking for freedom to worship God. How far we have gotten. The hope and the trust that people, or the trust that people once had in the church, has been eroded with things all the way from the sexual abuse all the way to the people standing in the pulpit saying that the scripture isn't even real or it's not even true. And I was at a Well, it was a pastor's a seminar type thing. And one of the presenters was a man from a seminary, and he was well known to some of the people there. I'd never heard of him before. But one of the things he said was that Paul was anti-Semitic. I said, what? Where in the world did he get that? And the people were just sitting there listening. And I'm thinking, how in the world? And things like that, though, can underwrite and undermine trust. The word in the scripture that Paul read, the words trust and hope are both listed in this chapter. There are wonderful things that the psalmist uses. And Christina was saying, because she always says, what are you preaching about? And I told her it's Psalm 71. So as she was reading it, she said, now, is this a Psalm of David? And I said, I don't know that it's a Psalm of David, but it sure has a lot of his mark on it. I would say it probably is. But there are words that are the very personal. The personal pronoun, my, is mentioned a lot. Referring to God, my trust, my hope, my rock, my refuge, my God. Oh God, don't be far from me. My God, make haste to help me. And so there are these words, hope and trust, that are both mentioned in the psalm. And some people might think they are synonymous. And maybe you think they're synonymous. Do they mean the same thing? Can you interchange them and it's kind of the same? Well, they are similar, but they're not the same. So which comes first? Does it even matter which one came first? And I believe that there certainly is a difference with them, and I think that it does matter which one comes first. I believe trust comes first. We build trust, and then we have hope because of the trust. And this kind of trust that is talked about here is from the Hebrew word kashah, which is like a well-fortified city. It means to take refuge in and to confide in. It's like running for protection. You think of a child and the parents, and who does the child trust? Well, he might not trust you because he doesn't know you, but he trusts mama, or he trusts daddy, and he'll go, if there's any trouble, usually goes running for mama. Now, I know that's not true of everybody. In fact, tragically, I know people who had a horrible upbringing and their experience with their mother. One lady in particular, I know her mother was terribly mean to her and told her just a little while before she died. She said, I'm sorry I ever had you. You know, and there's not a whole lot of trust there. You don't trust somebody like that. But trust is built on something, and it's in the New Testament, the words of pithio. And it means to have confidence or putio, or to trust or commit one's trust, or to entrust or commit. So you can put your hope in someone or something that you trust. And I love this in the first verse of Psalm 71. The psalmist says, in you, O Lord, I put my trust. I put my trust in you. I can trust you. Let me never be put to shame. Now, why would he say never let me put to shame right after saying, I love you or I trust you? Well, trust can be broken in a worldly sense. Trust can be broken. But hope comes when we feel that we can trust. Lack of trust leaves no basis for hope. How can you really have hope if you don't trust someone. You can't hope that what they say will come to pass. And lack of trust comes from a lot of different sources. It can come from a breach of that's caused by lies or miscommunication, even informed opinions and rumor and past experiences. All those things can affect our ability to trust. And I say we should trust. In the New Testament, and as Jesus was teaching, one of his main teachings that he would keep coming back to was about forgiveness. And forgiveness is like the bedrock that you can start to build trust on. You say, well, I don't trust them because of what they did to me in the past. Well, in the body of Christ, we might hurt one another. We might say something that hurts somebody. But we ask for forgiveness. We ask for healing of the thing, the breach that has happened. And then we go on. We come back for more, if you will. Amen. It's true. Or the formed opinions. How many times do we form opinions of people when we first meet them and we say, I don't like her. Boy, she's loud. I don't think I would want to ever have or a friend like that. Ended up being your best friend. Or some guy that's just loud and always has the answer before you even ask the question. One of my best friends, I had lunch with him the other day. He'd come into Bible study and he would start talking about how much he knew. And I found out later, yeah, he did know quite a bit. There was a lot that he didn't know, but he was really quick to tell me what he did know. And it took me a while to say, he's my brother. And I can trust him, and therefore, I have hope with giving him things to do. Trust is built over time and with experience, by time and experience. But it can be destroyed so quickly, can it? A mean, angry word can ruin the trust that we have. Well, does that mean we aren't going to trust ever again? No. The body of Christ, we say, Lord, my heart has been broken, and they did me wrong, but I know you love them anyway, and I'm going to forgive them. In the Sermon on the Mount, Jesus said, if you bring your gift to the altar and you remember that your brother has sinned against you, you go first and be reconciled to your brother, and then come and offer your gift. And the forgiveness part works on both sides. If we have hurt somebody, if we have done somebody wrong, we need to seek their forgiveness. We need to say, I am really, really sorry. Can you please find it in your heart to forgive me? If someone has hurt us, you may not have to go and find them and say, you really hurt me. And if you'll apologize, I'll try to forgive you. Well, that doesn't work. We just need to forgive them anyway, by the grace of God. And it's not something that always comes easily, but because once trust is broken, it's very hard to fix it. It's hard to repair it. But hope is a lifeline. And overarching all of the trust and the broken promises and things that we have in life, I can tell you for sure today that we can hope in the Lord. We can trust him. He's never done me dirt. He's never done me wrong. He's never failed me. And therefore, I put my hope and my trust in him. There's a word in fact, I would like to maybe read a couple of verses from Joshua, kind of an unlikely place you would look for something about hope. But Joshua 2:18 uses a word, it says, when we come into the land, this is talking about Rahab, the harlot. When we come into the land, you bind this line of scarlet cord in the window through which you let us down, unless you bring your father, and unless you bring your father, your mother, your brothers, and all your family's household to your. So she was offered protection and promised protection with this tikva, which is hope, to describe, and it described the scarlet rope that was tied to Rahab's window for her hope. It was what she was going to put out the window. It was the same cord, apparently, that the spies had been let down the wall. And I'm thinking, well, if they're going to try to be quiet and do this with the, you know, on the sly, why would they use a red cord? It's probably what they had. You use what you have. Anyway, she was a flawed individual. She was not the perfect specimen of godliness that you would look for or expect to find, that God would show hope to the nation of Israel through. But she took the spies in, this prostitute, she took the spies in, she protected them, and then she sent them on their way, and they got away. And so that anyone in her house would be saved. I want to read, actually, a little bit of the context, starting in verse 17. So the men said to her, "We will be blameless of this oath of yours, which you made us swear, unless when we come into the land, you bind this line of cord in the window through which you let us down, and unless you bring your father and your mother, your brothers, and all your father's household to your home. So it shall be that whoever goes outside the doors of your house into the street, his blood shall be on his own head, and we will be guiltless. And whoever is with you in the house, his blood shall be on their head if a hand is laid on him. And if you tell this business of ours, then we will be free from your oath, which you made us swear." And she was actually making a deal for the protection of her and her family. Puts me in mind of the Philippian jailer. Paul and Silas were in jail for preaching the gospel in Philippi, and they were singing praises at night. And they were in there in the stocks, and in the middle of the night, the angel of the Lord came and set them free, opened the doors of the prison. Everything was wonderful, and except for the jailer. And he said, "Oh my, I am going to be slaughtered at daybreak when the Romans find that the prisoners are gone." He was ready to fall on his sword and take his own life. And Paul said, "Don't hurt yourself. Don't hurt yourself." I need to read that too. Verse 28 of chapter 16, Acts 16, 28. "But Paul called out with a loud voice, 'Do not harm, do yourself no harm, for we are here.' Then he called for a light, ran in, and fell down trembling before Paul and Silas. He brought them out and said, 'Sirs, what must I do to be saved?' And they said, 'Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, and you will be saved, and your household.' Then they spoke the word of the Lord to him and to all who were in his household." So it was not only for this jailer, the Philippian jailer, for him to be saved, but it was for his household too. We trust the Lord, don't we? We trust the Lord for ourselves, and we pray, and we say, "Lord, help me get through the day, and help me through the next things that I'm going to be facing, and whatever is going on in my life, help me." But we can pray the same thing for our family, for our household. You say, well, thank you, Lord, that I'm saved. But I really feel bad for my brother or my aunt and uncle. Well, you can pray and you can claim the promise for them too. The Lord is going to work in their life and they will find the hope and trust that you have found because of you. Because of you. The Lord himself is the hope for the godly. He's our lifeline and our hope for safety. What show was it several years ago that it was a Who Wants to Be a Millionaire or something? And they would, well, you have one more lifeline and you can reach out and call somebody. Yes, I think you got three chances, didn't you? Am I right? Three chances, and you would all know what the lifelines were, probably. I barely remembered that there was a show. But we have a lifeline, and God is our lifeline. He is the one we reach out to, not sometimes, but all the time. In this sense, it is also the idea of patient waiting. We wait patiently for him. Well, it hasn't happened yet. Well, we need to wait patiently for him to come through. In the New Testament, the word for hope from the Greek is elpizo, and this is confident expectation with a sure basis. So there, it's not just, oh, I wish it could be so. Oh, I hope to win $1 million in the lottery this week. It's or something that's so far away, or it's just kind of wishful thinking. That's not hope that the Bible is talking about. It's got a basis. It's solid. It's anchored. The Lord is our hope today. The Lord is our hope. And I don't care what is going on in your family. I don't care what's been going on in your life. I don't care what's going on in the world. The Lord is our hope. He's the same yesterday, today, and forever. And the same God then is the same God right now, and he'll still be the same tomorrow. And you can take that to the bank, because that is our hope. That's the rock that we stand on. He is the one. It's not wishful thinking and wringing our hands saying, oh, gee whiz, I wish, or wouldn't it be nice? But it's certainty based on who God is. We trust him because of who he is. We trust him in his word. By the way, did you put up some of the signs around your home with verses on it? Some of the promises? If you haven't done it, get busy. Put those promises up. And you can look and say, I'm trusting in that one, Lord. I'm believing you for that. That's my confidence. For us, it also pertains to the second coming of Jesus, the return of our Lord Jesus Christ. It's talking about the hope of the people who die in the Lord, that we don't grieve as others grieve with no hope. In 1 Corinthians 12, Paul says, if in this life only we had hope, we've been be of all men most miserable. It says, King James says it the best, I think. We would be pitiful if this is it. If this is it. And I love life. But if this is it, you know, I'm getting rickety enough that life is a challenge, you know, just to get my hands working in the morning and make sure I get out to the coffee pot so I can get everything going. You know, it's a hard thing. I love life. But if this was it, it would be a pretty shallow thing. I feel my heart goes out to people who don't have hope of everlasting life. Hope is the extension of faith, and it's not inferior to faith. It's an extension, though, of our faith. Some people say hope and faith are the same. Well, they're not. It's a further walking in our faith. Faith is in the present possession of grace. hope is in confidence, is the confidence in grace's future accomplishment. Say it once more, because I worked hard at that. Faith is the present possession of grace. You believe, you're saved. Just like that. Just like that. You're saved. Now, how did you get saved? Through Jesus. Just like that. But hope is the confidence in grace's future accomplishment. Another thing we can think about is God is not finished with us. He's still working on us. He's still calling us to change. He loves us just like we are, but he loves us too much to leave us just the way we are. He wants to change us from glory to glory. Here a little, there a little. Line upon line, precept on precept. You guys are really patient, and thank you. I'll try to wrap it up. It's hot, isn't it? Excuse me. Titus 2:13, it says that we are looking for the blessed hope and glorious appearing of our great God and Savior, Jesus Christ. So we're looking for him. Back in Psalm 71, there are a lot of verbal references to praising the Lord. The psalmist uses the mouth, the tongue, praise, mention, declare, sing, lips, maybe others, to drive home the fact that our praise and our worship should be open and evident, not just quietly in our own little place at home, not just in our private prayer time, but we should be verbal and out with our praise. Or another one in Hebrews 13:15, it says, therefore, by him, let us continually offer the sacrifice of praise to God. That is the fruit of our lips, giving thanks to his name. The fruit of our lips, what's coming out of our mouth. My oldest sister, and she was just a little tiny girl, maybe 2 or 3 years old. My mom used to always sing as she would go through the house. Just, I don't know if your mom sang, but sad to say, sometimes now maybe the music gets turned on, the iPod, who knows what that is anymore. But the music gets turned on somehow, and people just let the music go. But my mother used to sing, and most of the songs were hymns. But sometimes she would hum instead of sing. And my oldest sister, her name was Alta. Alta said, Mom was humming one of these songs, and she said, Mama, sing it with your teeth. Sing it with your teeth. With your teeth. In other words, say it. Say the words. I want to know what you're singing. And I believe our praise should be with our teeth. We can do it out loud and let it be known who our God is. We need to say, like Psalm 39:7 says, my hope is in you. Or back in Psalm 75 or 71:5, I hope in your word. Or you are my hope. And Psalm 119, I hope in your word. Or Jeremiah 14:9, he says, oh Lord, you are in our midst, and we are called by your name. We're your people. Romans 5 says, well, first of all, I want to refer to Paul. He said he was standing before Felix, and Felix wanted to know, what's wrong with you? Why are you doing all this? And you've turned the world upside down, and you're causing trouble talking about this new way. And Paul says, I have hope in God. I have hope in God. In Romans 5, 1 and 5, he says, we rejoice in hope, and hope does not disappoint. Hope does not disappoint. And best of all, Jesus Christ is our hope. 1 Timothy 1:1 says this, Paul, an apostle of Jesus Christ, by the commandment of God, our Savior, and the Lord Jesus Christ, our hope. Amen. Lord, I pray you would go with us now. Pray that you would cover us with your protection and watch over us. And Pray especially that you would be with the furtherance of your gospel in us and through us. Lord, I pray that you would increase our ability to trust you. Help us to trust you no matter what. Help us now as we go. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
I bless you.
Be thou my vision, O Lord of my heart. Not be all else to me save that thou art. Thou my best thought in the day and the night. Waking or sleeping, thy presence, my life. Be thou my wisdom, be thou my true word. I ever with thee and thou with me, Lord. Thou my great Father and I thy true Son. Thou in me dwelling, and I with thee one. Be thou my breastplate, my sword for the fight. Be thou my armor, and be thou my might. Thou my soul shelter, and thou my high tower. Raise thou me heavenward, O power, my power. Riches I heed not, nor man's empty praise. Thou mine inheritance through all my days. Thou and thou only, the first in my heart. High King.